I have several male withdrawers who state openly how much they dislike coming to therapy with their mates. I have tried to gently be curious about how this makes them feel, but they have a tremendous sense of being overwhelmed and on the hot seat no matter what I say or do. I am so interested in how to work with these vulnerable, shutdown individuals.
I mean, that last bit from the previous question about knowing and stating and reflecting that we believe they're good with themselves.
Yeah.
Hopefully in stage one, the withdrawer will certainly acclimate to being in therapy. Will acclimate, you know, will tolerate their dread. You've heard from me before that I have had a client where we scale his dread at the beginning of every session. I make the dread okay. Like, I get it, you know, I'm sorry, I'll make it as painless as possible, as much as I can. Your dread makes perfect sense. This is the last place you'd want to be. And that makes sense to me. And that's okay with me. And I'm glad you can be honest with me about it. And hopefully as you're doing, working towards de-escalation, they start feeling the changes in their relationship. You know, their partner is less attacking, for instance, hopefully. Their partner is slowing down a little bit. But I get for a lot of withdrawers, that's just as scary. I mean, in a way, it's better than being attacked from a pursuer. But in another way, it's a different fear to have your partner slowing down and being more vulnerable, because I still don't know what to do with that. At least when I was being attacked or felt attacked, I could defend, I could fight back, I could do what I've always done.
Mm-hmm.
So even working towards de-escalation, and then certainly in stage two, they're on their leading edge. They are on the edge of their unknown constantly, and we just have to talk with them about that to make it as palatable as possible. We know we're asking, they're doing so much. At the summit last year in San Diego, or more than a year ago now, I heard myself say, I think withdrawers have a steeper hill to climb. For these exact reasons, they've spent their whole lives developing a coping strategy of avoiding their inner world. And then they, you know, their mate wants better connection with them from them. And so they have to start sharing pieces of their inner world that they didn't even know they had. And so it is overwhelming. A very little focus will often make them feel like they're in the hot seat. What would feel like not even hot to me feels excruciating hot to them. And so we just learn. I've had to let my withdrawers that fit in this question, I've had to let them teach me, you know, how hot is a hot seat? Just like how big is the dread? We just make their experience okay and we make space for it. And they've taught me that they both dread it more, they feel the hot seat more, and they're more exhausted than I ever had any idea they could be at the end of what I would call a normal session.
Right.
So they're sensitizing me.
Yeah, yeah.
To what's very clear to them and very, very common. Now I know to ask my withdrawers, you feel pretty raw, you must be exhausted, you've done a lot of work, you probably feel drained. Yeah, heck yeah. And so again, we've just talked process and make it okay for them to dread, to be overwhelmed, to not coming. It's okay to dislike coming and still come, and you appreciate the heck out of them for still coming. It's like how a lot of us feel about going to the gym or the dentist. You know we should, we know we need to. And we'll, you know, I dislike it thoroughly, but I know I need to do it. And so hopefully the dislike shrinks over time as the gains and as the pain, as the healing happens. The pain shrinks and the healing happens.
So you make room for it, you validate it, you reflect that it's real, you see it as an opening, it's a kind of expression, it's a pain in a sense.
Yeah.
And so,
it's to that point, Jen, sorry to talk over you, but to that point, that's where you have to start when you do steps 3 and 5 with them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, you don't want to start anywhere else. You don't want to make space for their overwhelm and feeling on the hot seat and how much they dislike coming, and then say, okay, that's good, but now I need to know where your sadness and fear are. You take overwhelm, hot seat, dislike, and you trickle down over session by session. And so the fact that they're even telling you they dislike coming, but that's a great portal, especially for someone who's been avoidant.
It's not a problem. It can feel like a problem. Certainly as a clinician, it has felt like a problem to me, but it is actually not a problem. It's a portal.
It's not a problem. It's a portal. It will be longer. You know, I have to slow way down and I have to increase my validation by fivefold. I have to really care for. I mean, I care for all my clients, but I really have to make my caring overt. I have to do all the things, you know, not that withdrawers are childlike by any stretch. I'm not trying to draw that conclusion. But we do lots of things that we would do for a vulnerable nervous system, whether it's a younger person or an older person. We do a lot of soothing.
A lot of soothing
and validation. Because this is hard.
Yep. Sorry, I'm talking over you. This was a brave step. This took so much courage. Yeah. Yes, you're exhausted. Yes, this is draining.
This takes all kinds of strength. This is a strength our culture doesn't recognize. You're brave enough, you're strong enough to come into a place where you dislike. I mean, wow. You must really love your person, and that's amazing.
You must really love your person. And so you reflect their love for their partner and their basic goodness and their courage and strength, and also how hard it is. And think of it as a portal, not a wall. Think of it as a portal, not a problem.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.